Joining us now is Dr. Robert Murphy. He's a professor of infectious diseases at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. Thanks for being with us again.
Good morning.
So we hear about these, you know, these numbers have ticked up over the summer. We hear about a lot of people having parties and whatnot. Is it going to take a matter of shutting things down 90% again to get this completely eradicated? Or would that would never happen? Would people be on board with that?
It's got to happen.
But will it?
And something has to be done. So some very serious action has to take place now, or we'll end up like California.
Yeah, I think when things felt a little bit better, people were excited about the idea of going back to school. Now there's a very mixed reaction about that. There was an article in the New York Times this morning about how Israel went back to school and things did not go well. Do you have any insight there?
Well, going back to school is a great thing. But if it cannot be done safely, it's not a great thing. And I think the Israeli experience is, I think we're going to replicate that the way things are now. Because we don't have the testing capacity, we don't have the assurity that every school can really follow the rules to keep the kids apart and to keep things safe. I don't think that exists right now with the numbers that we have. The numbers are bad.
So
I think it's not going to work.
When you say going back, though, and shutting things down, give me an idea of what you're saying. Do you really think the government is going to shut things down like they did back in March, or is that just wishful thinking? What do you see happening?
I don't think we have to do shelter in place. I think everybody has to just keep in mind, if everyone wore a mask in public, outdoors or indoors, and everybody stayed away at least 6 feet, minimum 3 feet, but ideally 6 feet, and washed their hands regularly, the whole thing goes away. Other countries have done this. We have been unable to do it for a variety of reasons. If we can do that, then we don't have to go completely backwards. But yeah. I think what the governor is trying to do is to enforce those very simple public health measures. And if we don't do it, then it gets very drastic.
Sweden had a more lenient approach. How are they doing today?
Terrible. Hmm. They're one of the worst records in Europe. They sort of just shrugged it off and say, well, we can live with it, blah, blah, blah. It did not work. They have one of the worst records in Europe.
All right. Well, let's go to a few questions here from the viewers. This person says, since the daily Illinois infection numbers have gone up from hundreds to the 1,000 range, the death rate has remained low, usually in the 20s or less. Is this a sign doctors are learning to treat the disease effectively, or is it something else?
Well, this is a really great observation. So there's a couple reasons for this. One is that from the time you get a case to the time the unfortunate people who die from the case, about approximately 1%, that takes about a month for that actually to happen. You get sick, you get in the hospital, you go to the ICU, et cetera. The other thing that's happened is the number of people the people that are getting infected now are much younger than the ones that did at the beginning. They survive better. They have a better survival rate. The other thing is we have remdesivir and we have dexamethasone. We have proven treatments that work against this disease, and more of them are coming along. And then the final thing is that we have experience now in treating this. And so the doctors are better at treating COVID cases. So all those things together are lowering the death rate, and that's fantastic, but there's still people dying.
All right, next question. If it took us 6 months to do 60 million COVID-19 tests in America, how long will it take to do 100 to 200 million COVID-19 vaccines in America?
This person is really thinking a lot. The idea of distributing 200 to 300 million vaccines in this country that's a huge thing. That's going to take a minimum of a year to do it. Maybe even longer than that.
And people think this vaccine is going to be a cure-all, but it only could be like 50% effective, kind of like the flu shot. Is that true?
Well, we don't know.
Yeah.
Great question. And we have to know that answer. What the government has said is that they are willing to accept a 50% efficacy rate, like the flu vaccine, that will save a lot of lives. Hopefully, you know, it'll be in the 80s or 90%. And then, you know, really we'll save a lot of people. But we don't know, and that's why we do clinical studies.
All right, here's the next question. When the phase three clinical trials are over, will those who participated learn whether they were given the vaccine or placebo? Because if they were given the vaccine, they wouldn't need it again, right?
Well, yeah, this is a very standard question for clinical trials. At the end of the clinical trial, people should find out whether they had the vaccine or placebo, and if they had placebo, they should be offered the vaccine. So that's basically that standard operating procedure. Whether or not they're going to need a booster or a dose next year, again, we don't know, but we'll find out from the clinical trials.
All right, Dr. Murphy, thanks for being with us again. If you have a question for him, you can go to our Morning News Facebook page and post it there. We'll talk to him again tomorrow. Have a good day.
Thanks, doctor.
Great. Have a good day, too. You too.